to add up the foundation in order itself. So coming up finally is foundation by Mr. Raymond Ng. So in order of by small. So Raymond will be sharing about the overall trends, the blockchain technology as mentioned by the gentleman just now, and also from about historical perspective. So Raymond will also be talking about how blockchain technology can be used in financial institutions in economic economy especially, which is also a pivot for my world. So without further ado, let's put our hands together to welcome Raymond.
Thanks to my friend for coming today, and thanks to the friends for coming today. Okay, so let me, this is some of the special friends for you. I just want to pass. This is Mr. Colin Goh, he's my good friend, and he's the director of, I think, maybe one of them is Stephen Tobola. So he's a right more in this statement. Raymond, when you said market cap, he's on the mind, and I get paid. The way it's been. Second, there are other ones that they were talking about. This one, I'm very blessed and very fortunate to get this comment from a lawyer, because coming from a lawyer is a bit different, because he's basically he's saying that before consulting a lawyer, before you do anything, just read my book. Okay? Price of the small provider, reader of holistic picture of the three big components of the law, finance, and law. Rather than using the law and the afterthought, and most of the ICO are sent in the afterthought. During the design of the blockchain economics, provide the reader and decide how to design the what way for a deal. Okay? And very fortunately for the lawyer, his name is Samuel Sharp. Okay, this is Mr. Jamie, he's over there. So Raymond's ability to simplify hard topic combined with his in-depth knowledge of history comes together and is relevant to today's biggest acknowledgement trends. Blockchain and decentralized, highly recommend people for anyone eager to understand the fundamentals of driving today's mega trend. Okay, so let's go to the both sides of the point. Because you see, whenever we talk about blockchain, it's often quite a highly contested topic. There are the people who are traditional, there are people who are a little blockchain, a bit overzealous. So the traditional people will just say Bitcoin is problematic because of the lack of regulation. Okay? Then the people who are for both Bitcoin, they will say Bitcoin is geared towards digital. Just like gold. That's why I use the picture of gold to represent the value of Bitcoin. Okay? So this is the both sides. But I tell you the truth, both of these sides are not it. Okay? Look at both of these sides, doesn't really touch on the main point of what is at stake. Okay? So you see, we're talking about the history of regulation. The first thing already is the New York Stock Exchange. The New York Stock Exchange was formed in the year 1792, okay? SEC was formed in 1934. So from 1792 to 1934, in 142 years, there was no regulatory body. And yet, one of the biggest naming companies we grew out of this blockchain. Like even some of the names that even now, even Shell, all the petrol companies, okay? But of course, before that, they were called Standard Oil. So I think they were listed Standard Oil during the first 2 years of the storage. So the thing is that history of regulation, many people always say if Bitcoin is regulated, it's better. Well, yeah, it's sometimes true, sometimes not true, okay? And because the thing is that if it never happened before, if the thing is that the stock exchange had grown even before there was regulation, if they could have grown without regulation, what makes you think regulation would improve things? It's sometimes true, sometimes not true, okay? The argument that something is valuable because of limited, okay, the thing is that there are a lot of things that are limited. Does it make it valuable? Of course not. Okay? It doesn't mean that anything that's limited by virtue is valuable. So this criteria of judging whether Bitcoin's value is bloody waste of time. It's just waste of time. Okay? It is not the main thing to focus on. Okay? So when you look at the wrong cause and effect, okay, sometimes it really is true, sometimes it's false. Like for example, say is regulation good, or sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not good. Okay? So if you ask me whether banks are good, sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not good. Okay? If you ask me is paying tax good, sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not so good. Okay? Because you may be taxed for the wrong reason. There are people who tax for the number of reading words and stuff. So that one is not people. But you see, my point I want to say this is that if you want to understand something based on something that is sometimes true and sometimes not true, okay, is your understanding. Okay? If a statement is sometimes true and sometimes not true, then the statement is just not true. End of story. There is no causal relationship between the two. Okay? So if we got to find something that is true all the time, at least be 99% true all the time. For you to see the cause and effect of blockchain success, you have to have a measure that is true 99.99999% time. Okay, because I have a scientific training, I will never really use 100%. Because even the theory that we learned 400 years back, they give out a couple examples. Or even like Newton law, for example. But let us not do that. But my point is that you cannot find a principle that is even true 80% of the time and say that it's true. But if it's true only 80% of the time, I would just say it's not true. End of story. Because it's only true 80% of the time. It got to be true 99.99% of the time. In fact, once there's one single problem example, I cannot believe the thing. Because there's one problem example. Okay? So let's see, what is the thing that is true 99.999% of the time? Okay, or blockchain. So let's just focus on one thing that people don't really talk about. And this is the thing that people don't talk about is the cost. Is the factor that you look at what is driving blockchain technology and blockchain value. First of all, you focus on the transaction feature. Okay? Just focus on the transaction feature. Or the lack thereof. See, without friction. Let's turn back the clock. Simplest is that money was stolen at the time. Of course, before that, people often trade by other trade. So I bring four chickens to a chip and the one to pick up the things there. But it's very easy to carry around money. But if I were to carry money around, if I were to carry coins around, that is easier for me. So I can just travel easier. So in a way, money, putting aside whether it is, people always complain about this fractionalism or this kind of thing. Putting that aside, money as a result helps you to transact faster, right? As compared to carrying four chickens around to trade for a book. Okay? So money is a enabler of faster transaction. Okay? So of course then you come to the point of credit card. Credit card is the fastest transaction of money because you don't even need to carry money around you. So the credit card becomes like, depending on your credit, you could be carrying millions of dollars around in your credit card, or maybe 100,000, depending on credit. So therefore, this is the faster capitalist of money. Because it allows you to use trade greater volume, greater amount. Okay, you can buy more things, you can handle more. So this is the credit card. Okay. So you see between these two things, there is one common thread, which is the transactional friction is reducing as technology. Okay. That's the only thing that is true. And it's true 99.99%. Okay? Putting aside whether money is backed by gold or backed by silver, whatever, all the answer, these are true some of the time, not true some of the time. Okay? Then of course financial and technology and e-payments came about. Okay, so you have PayPal, Stripe, Alipay, Zimo. I mean that's one of my first ones. So basically, e-payment solution. Okay, e-payment solution. So this one even make it even faster. You don't even need to carry your credit card. Okay? And of course you know that Alipay and WeChat Pay, of course in China is adopted very, very Even old people like 70-year-old people, they go out with. That's how they save it. Okay. So the thing is that, like you see, then there's one thing that changed in this comparison. The main thing that changed is that becoming faster. They mean the transaction is even more than 1%. Okay? 1%. I mean it's even and more people paying each other for services rendered, okay? And allow for faster transactions. This one is way faster than money, way faster than money. Although, to be fair, they are still, the backend is still powered by the credit card, and they have a credit card number. But if you have the one time, then you can use your bank account now, then over and over and over again. Same as WeChat, same as IP, okay? So it's even faster. You make it even faster and more convenient. Of course, the next stage is blockchain. So if you see through this line of evolution, you don't really see blockchain as separate from money or an enemy of money. It's not. Okay? It is because most of my blockchain peers who are trained in technology, they have never read history books. That's the reason why. They've never read history books, so that's why they thought that, this is something new that is compared to money. But if you see money as a lubricant or as a catalyst, then you just see that in the form of the form of the common medium of exchange transforms itself. They mean it changes form and change shape. Okay? So when you look at this from this point of view, there was no revolution in it. There was no revolution means that you come out and cover the people that, that's why in my book I say evolution, I never say revolution. Revolution is bloody. I'm a very peace-loving person. So I don't believe in revolution, I believe in evolution. Revolution is less blood. Okay? So the thing is that in a blockchain system, of course, you have Bitcoin and Ethereum and whatever, it is actually an IS and And actually, to be fair to them, they actually dissolve a lot of blockchain. They allow so many people to transact at one time. So, okay, the blockchain system. So when you look at this train of thought, do you see that now you see that there's a common evolution pattern. There is the undeniable direction of history, of the evolution of money, the evolution of common medium. So from a historical standpoint, if you see from the past 5,000 years of history, you may see the trend. You just see that it becomes more and more effective. You don't see that some blockchain, you don't see that Satoshi Nakamoto is trying to overturn money. I don't see that way, but I just see it as it's an inevitable evolution. I see it as an inevitable evolution. And it's not an unhealthy evolution. It's just that it's more fluid, it's more liquid, it's more smoother, it has lesser transactivity, it allows more people to transact one another, and therefore it's a result, like what Mr. Ting said just now, there are so many unbanked people, so if the transaction may even go down for all the people, then they can participate. Because these people, you know, when they open the bank account, they probably open it small, but then the bank will say, don't bother me, I just want to open it. So there's one possibility. The other possibility is some of the Vietnamese have told me that I don't trust the bank. Even I got millions of dollars under the bed, I was broke with the bank. So there's another group of people. There's another group of people there. They have a lot of money, but they don't put in the bank. They don't have a bank account. So the blockchain will make that even resolve the trust issue and therefore allow more people to invest. Okay? So you see, now that you look at it from the grand scale of design, there is not really a line dividing the blockchain or non-blockchain finances. There's no, to me there's no one. Because it's just that things becoming more and more effective. All money, technology and blockchain system all have differences with only one commonality. They are economic lubricant, catalyst, and they are getting better. Okay? That is an undeniable trend. When you look at it from the viewpoint of historical, it's clear. And, okay, at this moment maybe I see something on the floor. Okay. If there is any blockchain peer that I have here, please stop this concept about gold being like the epitome of value. This concept, okay? Gold was there to draw history, yes, but that one is too big a statement. Gold was value, but it's only until 400 years ago it became tied to money. It's only 400 years ago, and it's because our dear heroes by the name of Sir Isaac Newton, now you probably heard the name, okay? Sir Isaac Newton make an error, and that's why gold becomes a fashion. You're gonna say that gold has undeniable value because someone make an error, even though he may be Isaac Newton. Okay, the Isaac Newton, you're not hearing it wrong. He is a famous physicist. and all those who study O-level physics, you have been tortured by him. Yes. All those who study O-level physics or A-level, you have been tortured by him. But actually, in his career as a scientist, half of it is as a scientist. The other half is really as a central banker. But this one wrong problem. He was equivalent as a central banker in that time. So actually, when Newton made an error, then everyone else repeat that gold has undeniable value and all that. Come on, then it's just nonsense. Okay? Gold does not have unquestionable value. You see, look at gold. You dig up the ground, make the gold bar, then you bury it back to the ground. And then after that, you come into there, man. There's no value. The amount of gold that is in circulation is very little. Really, it's a small value. Don't eat that one. Okay? But of course, what I say about transaction theory, is this theory or is this observed in real life? I mean, definitely it was observed in history, that's just okay. Okay, it was definitely observed in history. Because of the undeniable record of how money is for society. That was undeniable. But what about recent time? Okay? So you see, don't worry about the numbers beside, we just look at the shape of the graph. Okay? This graph is an indicator, okay, basically the formula is January. Okay? During this time, the Bitcoin transaction fee increased from less than $1 to $50 per transaction. That means the friction increased. The friction increased. Okay? So what happens to the market? The market will always reflect its true valuation. Okay? So you see, January 2018. Here. 2018. This is the number of unique users. Okay, unique address. Some address may be used by 2%. So some person may have 2 or 3 addresses. So you see, after the highest transaction, the number of wallet. Just look at the trend. Don't bother the number. Well, because we must see, we must understand it from the principal standpoint. High transaction friction increase usage, increase value. Okay? Number of address. Number of address is decreasing. That means lesser people you. I mean just for discussion. At this point of time, it's 1 million per day. Until here is 5.2 million. It's by because of the high connection. Because of the high price of the fee is also means that high connection. Okay? So it increased. And then of course, as a result of that, January 2018. The time will take the energy. This is a market cap, maybe the price will go up. When you hit the maximum level, that means that your this Bitcoin transaction has high transaction. It means a high friction. Therefore it comes down. It comes down. Okay? Bitcoin sent per day, January 2018, it was at the peak. But when you hit the highest transaction, all the users go up. Just look at the data, it's you see, I personally, I don't really need in Bitcoin. I have no interest to buy Bitcoin at $1 and sell it at $10,000. What interests me more in the okay? But honestly, if I really do want to hunt Bitcoin, honestly, I will not look at some of the media they talk about the thing. I want to talk about it because, they will talk about a lot of things that are not really known. Okay? But honestly, not that I didn't write the book for hunters to hunt. Okay? That's the thing I understand. I didn't write the book for that purpose. But if you really do want to hunt, I also can't stop you. But at the very least, I will not read this book. If I want to read the question, I will just look at this graph, how many users are using the phone, and whether the potential fee is high. And don't think high, quite a lot of this case of don't worry so much about Bitcoin utilizing okay, I mean sometimes you can talk for interest sake. You get my point. So this I don't know whether you guys see as sort of evidence. Because I see repeating many times. Not just Bitcoin, I actually put up many others. Okay? Because the number of people using it, the friction that it has. Drop. For the lack of friction, go up. Okay. can ask me anything other than to ask me whether to buy Bitcoin. I don't answer the question. Okay.
Okay.
So, and as a result, you see, okay, this is the average of the Bitcoin with respect to the Bitcoin. So when the Bitcoin is going up, so of course you're looking for the alternative, but the alternative they choose is to the. So at this point, you see that it's actually quite low until it was the people who are using Bitcoin who scan the fee of Bitcoin. This so there was a small peak here. But it's still small compared to Bitcoin. It's still small. But when you look at it, it's a big guy from compared to the other, it's not so low. They switched to Ethereum. And therefore, as a result, Ethereum, January onwards, it's one month. This trend, they have upper trend, they own the product. And that's the reason why Ethereum is good to own the product. Own the core, and what you do at some point online. What you see from the viewpoint of the confusion, you are 99.99999%. Right? You're correct. Okay? You can see why you go up and then, of course you know that it is, you know the thing is that when the people leave Bitcoin and use Ethereum, then the Bitcoin price, the Bitcoin is going to go down. Then you will see that the Ethereum will go back to thing. So you will see a seesaw effect. So when you see a seesaw effect, it's going to go down. People who buy, there are people who come to me and say, I bought Bitcoin at 20,000 or I bought Ethereum at 1,004. Now I'm losing money. First of all, I'm not for you. Okay, I'm not really for you. But first thing first, if you have read my book before, you won't have made that mistake. But my book is not for you. Yes, it is. It's for a more glorious objective, not for you. Okay? The price is the manifestation of value. Okay, so this is the current price of USD. As more and more people using it, what at the same time the price of material will go up. Again, because of seesaw effect, you will do as well. Whether they will go back to the same people. Okay, so let's talk about the three areas. You guys, as a management consultant, like, okay. In my education, when I was young,